Hey friends, it's Azure Friday. I'm Scott Hanselman and I'm here with Ricky Brundritt, and we're talking about visualizing data with the Azure Maps web control. How are you, sir?
I'm doing great. So the Azure Maps is a nice, powerful web service for your mapping needs. Mm-hmm. And so we have a JavaScript map control. It uses WebGL for rendering.
Oh, really?
And and it does full client-side vector rendering. And so we've seen in previous videos that the there's over 400 different elements used for styling the base maps. Mm-hmm. And with that, you can do some really powerful visualizations. In theory, if you wanted to, you could create a custom style that maybe emulates the color patterns of a taco.
Mm-hmm. That would be nice. I would appreciate that. That's interesting because, over the years, we've all seen map controls that mm-hmm. have been largely, tiled, generated, server-side generated bitmaps. Mm-hmm. And when you scroll in, you see the kind of uncomfortable popping in of squares, and they don't really scale. And then I've had situations in the past where I've put 5 or 10 pins on a map, and I feel that it's slow.
Right.
But you're saying you're using modern browser techniques to render these as vectors in a very performant way.
Correct. And with that, we're able to render a massive amount of data on the client compared to older map technologies that we've used.
Really?
Rendering tens of thousands of push pins is not unrealistic if you wanted to do that.
Seriously.
And the same thing when it comes to polygon data as well.
Yeah.
And we'll take a look at that in a little bit. Some other cool things about the map control is it supports 27 languages, which is what you need if you're creating a global app.
Yep.
And in addition to that, the map data, so that's the most important part of the whole map, mm-hmm. is updated weekly.
Seriously, weekly.
Weekly.
That's interesting because, again, in the past, when I think about other map systems, it's all rendered bitmaps and tiles that are terabytes in size. Really switching over to modern techniques and vectors makes it better for everybody.
Correct, yeah. So, we don't need to worry about pre-rendering tiles and things like that. It's because it's vector, as soon as we make the update in the data and publish that, mm-hmm. it's instantly available to users.
I see that you're in Visual Studio, yeah. and I use Visual Studio a lot. Is this easy for me to go and add into my web application?
Yes. And so if we take a look at Visual Studio here, mm-hmm. we'll see what's involved. So first thing you need to do is simply add a reference to the CSS file and to the JavaScript file for the map control. Mm-hmm. From there, you would simply, inside of your body of your page, you would add a simple div for your map,
okay.
Give it some style for sizing. And then inside of JavaScript, we would simply go through and create an instance of the map and pass in the ID of the div that we want the map to render in. Mm-hmm. We'd also pass in the subscription key for your Azure Map subscription.
Right.
And if you want, you can even set in the center and zoom level, and there's a ton of other options you can set as well. Mm-hmm. If you wanted to just take this example and go a little bit further besides just rendering a map, maybe you want to show traffic on top of that map.
Sure.
It's really easy to do. A couple lines of code, you say map.setTraffic, and we say, okay, we want the incident data to appear, and we want the flow information to appear as an absolute flow. So there's a lot of different types of flow data that can be rendered. So for traffic flow, you could have it relative to the speed limits. It could be
I see. So like if it's idealized speed, right. is it slower than usual?
Right.
Or absolute, where it's like green or red, depending on traffic?
Correct. Yeah. So yeah, is it slow? Is it fast? Or what have you? So yeah, there's a lot of different ways to kind of visualize that. So if we mm-hmm. actually switch in here, so here we go. We can actually go through and see those differences.
So there's your relative flow, and everything's green, so
yeah.
relatively okay.
Yeah, and then if we switch into to absolute, we can see that there's more red showing up over
right.
here.
Reality is that, in this case, down there in Seattle, not so good.
Yeah, and similarly, there's some other ones, such as relative to the delay. So yeah, if there's a delay, and the how worse is it compared to the delay?
Mm-hmm. I'm noticing as you're moving around, it's very kind of fluid. And I assume you can zoom in and zoom out.
Yeah, that's correct.
It's interesting. When you zoomed and zoomed out, I noticed that the Belltown neighborhood name kind of like moved around with you.
Mm-hmm.
You know it's a vector. Look at the word, like look at Second Avenue as you zoom out and First Avenue.
Yeah.
Those words aren't tiles. It is all vector based. You said it was WebGL?
Yeah. Yes, that's correct.
Fantastic.
Yeah. So some interesting things about the traffic data that's inside the map control
mm-hmm.
Is that it's updated every 5 minutes, and so it's whenever you get some traffic information, it's within 5 minutes of the actual traffic conditions.
That's great. So maps updated weekly based on vectors with five minute traffic. Like, that's a level of freshness I don't think that we are used to.
Yeah, that's correct. And the traffic data is available in 55 countries as well.
Seriously.
Yeah. So going forward, another thing I wanted to show is this monstrosity of a map.
Why did you do this, Rick?
And this is more so my go for broke example. You know, uh-huh. If you wanted to render a lot of data on the map, you can do that. So this example here is rendering 167,000 shapes on the map. About a third of them are polygons, a third are pushpins, and a third are polylines or line strings. And so there's 140 megabytes worth of GeoJSON data being rendered on the map right mm-hmm. here.
So you tried to break it on the system. You can see the megabytes of data that you're loading into it here to see if you can break this thing.
Exactly. That's what I wanted to do.
Let's see if you broke it.
And so we can zoom in. As we zoom in here, we can see it's actually pretty fluid.
So you've added all the different waypoints, the line strings, all the features. Correct. Hundreds of thousands of items.
Yeah, so yeah, we have the road lines here, we have the addresses for the individual properties, and then we even have the outlines for the properties or parcel boundaries. And what's even cooler is, even though we have all the shapes, we can easily just click on them, and we have events tied into it, and we can read all the metadata for each one as well.
Wow.
And so we can quickly jump through it. So even though we have all this data being handled in WebGL, we're able to still have fluid map visualizations and mouse events as well.
That's amazing. I would not expect at this point, with all of that stuff loaded up, especially that it's using JavaScript, that it could be that responsive. But the browser is working nicely. You're zooming in and zooming out. Mm-hmm. The map is responsive. So it can take basically anything you throw at it. So anything that your commercial or your Azure-based applications can
right.
handle,
yeah, and
the maps can handle.
And the one question you have to ask yourself, though, is where is your data, and does it make sense for the user to download it all?
Yeah.
At 140 megabytes, if it's a client-side, or if you have that data locally, mm-hmm. then adding it to the map directly probably makes sense. It's nice and easy. But if it's server-side, maybe sitting in SQL Azure, mm-hmm. then you might want to start looking at creating a web service to pull in data as needed rather than downloading the whole blob of data.
Well, and that brings up another interesting point, because you commented that you've got all the different events that are available mm-hmm. to you. You could certainly, if you needed this level of data, just do it on demand as
correct.
They get into that appropriate zoom level and that...
Just load the data that's
that
in the map
view. Just load the data that's in the map port. That's fantastic.
Yeah.
But it's nice to know, and it's comforting to know, if I was going to put this into one of my applications in Azure, that you can handle anything I throw at you.
Correct. So the next thing, you love this map, you want to use it, where do you go? You have to look at the docs. So mm-hmm. if you go to aka.ms/Azure Maps docs,
okay.
nice and simple, you'll get taken to our docs page here. And you can go through, and not only do we have, textual content on docs, but we actually have interactive code samples right inside the docs.
And oh, wow. So these are live. That's not a picture.
Yeah, this is live. So we go through here, and now here's how you set the camera for the map. Mm-hmm. And so if we just simply wanted to change the zoom level to 2, we should see that the map updates on the right.
Nice.
And so there's... as you go through the samples, get more and more complicated to do more and more things. Mm-hmm. But it provides you with a nice, rich, environment to not only learn by reading, but also learn by trying with the Azure Maps API.
Very cool. So then anyone who's watching right now can go into portal.azure.com. They can set up Azure Maps, get their subscription key, check out the demos, and then you can probably integrate this into your own systems just in days.
Yeah, exactly.
Very cool. I am learning all about the Azure Maps web control here on Azure Friday.